Hello, and welcome to the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics podcast series. The aim of this podcast series is to keep you up to date with the latest information from renowned experts across the globe on all things home economics related. My name is Dr. Elaine Mooney, and I am the Director of the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics at St. Angela's College in Sligo. On today's podcast, I am joined via Teams by Professor Mary Flynn to discuss the healthy eating guidelines for children aged 1 to 4. Dr. Flynn is a registered dietitian and a public health nutritionist. She is Chief Specialist in Public Health and Nutrition at the Food Safety Authority of Ireland and is a visiting professor at Ulster University. Over the last decade, much of Mary's work has focused on infant and child feeding. She currently leads an international working group setting nutrient reference standards for infants and young children. Thank you, Mary, for joining me today. Mary, you have led the research team at the Food Safety Authority that established the scientific basis for the different types and amounts of food that best meet the needs of toddlers and preschool children in Ireland. And this is the evidence that underpins these healthy eating guidelines.
Yes, and the work that our team conducted is all explained in a report which is available on our website. So FSAI, Food Safety Authority Ireland, .ie, and just look for healthy eating recommendations for 1 to 5 year olds, and you'll find our report. And that goes through all of the steps. So we first, you know, have to look at the nutritional requirements of the age group. It's a tremendous period of physical and mental development and emotional development, bringing a child from one, where they're just coming out of infancy, up to the age of 5 when they're just going into primary school.
Okay, and I suppose, Mary, one thing that struck me from the report, it's very clear that toddlers and preschoolers have very high nutritional requirements relative to their size. And your work also highlights how the dietary habits formed during this critical phase can actually last a lifetime. So I suppose before we look at the actual guidelines, could you outline, Mary, the nutritional needs of this particular group?
I'm very happy to do that. It's a very interesting period, and a lot around the world, a lot of countries have looked at infant feeding guidelines, and then they look at health eating guidelines from the age of 5 upwards, because they feel that between infancy, between 1 and 5, it's a transitional stage where a child is coming off a mainly milk diet. And as they progress from the age of 1 to 5, there's progressively more solid food coming into the diet. So the amount of milk that an infant is on by the time they're 12 months, by the time they're 1 year, is about 500 mils, 500-600 mils, about a pint in old terms. But of course, we don't give it just as milk. We give it as milk, yogurt, cheese, a selection. And that stays the same from 1 until they're 5. And what happens is more and more food is added in, more solid food. But what they are going through is phenomenal. And food is the fuel for all of that growth and development. So if you think of a 1 year old, many of them are just crawling. Some of the early developers might be up on their feet and toddling around. I've known one or two who are actually running around with no sense to go with it because they're only one. And then the ones who are a little bit wiser and sitting down, taking everything in, mightn't start to get up on their feet until they're 18 months old. So there's a wide spectrum of variability within the group in terms of their food needs, because obviously the more active ones will need more food than the quieter ones. But throughout that period as well, of course, they're going to learn how to hop, how to jump, how to climb. And in terms of their other skills, fine motor skills, they learn how to draw and to write by the time they're 5, when you think about it. And their mental ability and their emotional ability and their communication. So there's an awful lot going on. And an adequate diet is really important so that they reach their full potential. And the other thing that's happening is, that's what we see, if you like, on the outside. But on the inside, all of the organs are developing, like the kidneys, the liver, and we know the brain. For example, when a child is born, the brain is about 25% of the adult size. By the time the child is three, it's 80% of adult size. And by the time it's five, the child is five going to school, it's 90%. So it's very important that there's a good nutritional intake so that that development isn't compromised in any way. And the other thing that I suppose is important to mention is that this is a critical window for children to get exposed to all of the tastes that they that are from a healthy variety of food. For example, we know fruit and vegetables have very bitter flavors, some of them don't smell very good, and actually those harsh smells and those bitter tastes are what we know can protect us against diseases such as cancer. So it's very important that a child is exposed to these foods, and of course they'll refuse it again and again and again, but keep exposing, and familiarity you know, they'll acquire the habits they need for a lifetime, because it is very, very difficult. And I have met people who, you know, went managed to go through childhood digging in their heels and not touching fruit and vegetables. And that's a difficult thing to manage when you're an adult, to have a healthy diet by leaving out a complete food group. So from one to five, not only is it about adequately feeding them, and they have a very tiny little tummy, so you have to maybe break the meals up into mini meals, you know, and give it several times a day, and meet their nutritional requirements, which are very high relative to their size. But you're also trying to make sure that they have get familiar with all of the staple foods. By that I mean, you know, the vegetables, salads, fruit, the pastas, the rice, the potatoes, the brown breads, and of course the dairy foods, the milk and cheese and yogurt, all of those things that will really help them, you know, when they're older, to have a healthy diet.
And Mary, if you, you know, when you discuss the nutritional needs there, if we get down into the specifics maybe of, you know, like looking at protein or carbohydrates, what would you say in relation to that, even calories?
Well, it is tricky, because I've just described, even at the 1 year stage, some children are hardly moving and others are running around. But on top of that, some are naturally small, and some children are naturally, you know, very tall and much bigger. And part of that is genetic. So what we're trying to do in terms of giving enough calories and enough protein is we're trying to make sure they reach their full potential that's been given to them through their genetics. So that, you know, if they're meant to be tall, that if you didn't give enough energy or protein, you could compromise how tall they, you know, they have the potential to be. And that's not a good, that's not good. We don't see much stunting, thank God, in Ireland. But if we go to countries where there isn't enough food, you'll see what happens to those young children. We have stunting, and we know that then when they're older, that stunting must have also affected internal organs, because they're much more vulnerable to cardiovascular disease and cancer and early mortality. So having a good diet at this, you know, enough food to make sure all the organs develop. So you've asked me about calories, and that was the trickiest part for us. How do we give out dietary guidelines to a population that cover all the needs of that, you know, that variation in needs, if you like? So what we did is we used the World Health Organization growth charts, and we worked out the calories for the tiniest, the middling, and the tallest children at several different age points. And we modelled, we looked at the preschool National Nutrition Survey, which looked at 1 to 5 year old children living in Ireland. And we looked at those foods that they were eating, and we use those to make up diets, to model diets. And that gave us insight into how do you give enough calories for a small child to grow well, for a middling child, an average child, if you like, and a very large child. And we that gave us huge insight into the fact there's very little room for cakes and biscuits and sweets. That really the food that this age group take, it's very important that it's nutritious, that it's giving nutrients all the time. And so the challenge, I suppose, is within whatever their calorie requirements are for growth, you don't give them too much because that'll end up in obesity. You don't give them too little. And generally, we can rely on appetite as long as we there's other things, like we do have fussy eaters. So routine is very important. Okay. All of those things.
And Mary, so in relation to, I know you said there about calories, in relation to carbohydrates, are we looking at, you know, the complexity of, complex carbohydrates? You're looking there at fiber versus sugar. Are you at that level?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So when we modeled the diets, we were pretty sure from other literature, if you like, that at that young age group, their fiber needs are easily met. They don't have the same requirement as older age groups that everything has to be wholemeal. So a mixture of white and brown, very important to expose the child to wholemeal bread, because that's what they'll be, we need to push them towards when they're older, because we have a very high rate of colon cancer in Ireland. And we know that our dietary fiber intake is low. Dietary fiber can protect us. So what we do with the carbohydrates for this 1 to 5 year old group, and we only discovered this through the modelling, is that a mixture of brown and white breads, potatoes, pasta, rice. And we didn't want it to be too high in fiber for this age group, because that can be very bulky and can blunt their appetite then for other foods, you know, and they won't get enough. But we needed to be low in sugar. So, you know, if it's a bland diet, where sugar will come in is where you want to make a healthy food more attractive. So, for example, porridge is an excellent cereal. We'll talk about cereals because some of the fortified ones have a very important place in this age group's diet. So it's not all about porridge, but maybe to accept porridge, a tiny bit of sugar in porridge wouldn't be a problem. Or a little bit of jam on wholemeal bread, or a little bit of sugar in stewed fruit, but always thinking about where it's coming in terms of making a nutritious food more acceptable, if you like.
I suppose then the exact same could be said for fats, so that you're looking at not too much as very high, it's very high in calories, but you still want to provide the essential fatty acids.
Absolutely. So what we'd say is minimal added fat. So if you have, like, for example, chips would not be a good idea. Fried food for this age group, not a good idea, because it gives a lot of calories without giving any other nutrients. But say if you wanted roast potatoes, thicker cut kind of roasted potatoes once a week wouldn't be a problem. But otherwise, you know, a little bit of butter or spread on bread, and you know, they'll have enough of their essential fatty acids from their meat, chicken, fish, from their dairy products. Vitamin D is a bit of a problem. So we will talk about what kind of supplements they need later. The fat, yeah, would be minimal added fat, minimal added sugar, no added salt. Their taste buds are extremely sharp. It's no good for an adult to check out what it tastes like, because it tastes bland to us, but to a 1 to 5 year old child, they'll get far more flavor than we get from our food. So no added salt, important.
Mary, you did mention dairy products, and this isn't in the guidelines, but it's something that has always interested me, is for those young children who don't take much cow's milk, what is the alternative source there for iodine for them, or is it necessary for
that is a big question, and happy to tell you, Elaine, and other teachers who are listening, that we explored this in far more depth after we finished putting together the dietary guidelines for the government. So we did further research through one of my colleagues who's doing a PhD, and we found that iodine, you know, it can be a problem, particularly for those who avoid all dairy. So it's we in Ireland get most of our iodine from milk. And it's not really that milk is naturally a good source. It's the kind of feeds that are used in dairy herds are iodine supplemented. So that's why there'll be more iodine in the milk, yogurt and cheese. But also the biggest probably source of iodine from milk is they use iodophore disinfectants to sanitize the teats of the cow while they're milking through the milking process. And this means that iodine is a very, you know, the biggest source of iodine in the Irish diet is milk. So it is a problem for us if somebody doesn't take any dairy. Iodine is definitely a nutrient that we need to think of, because the only other sources are fish. Now, white fish is actually a far richer source of iodine than oily fish. So oily fish is good for your omega fatty acids and vitamin D, and white fish is good for iodine, cod in particular. And actually cod from Norwegian waters are higher in iodine than those from the Atlantic. That's just a side issue. But of course, we only advise fish, you know, about twice a week because of, you know, contaminants and different things. So the rest of the diet is quite poor. It's like you'd find it in maybe you'd find a little bit in egg, little bit in meat and poultry, but not much. So most of the rest of the world iodize salt, and they use that then maybe when they're making bread that we buy in the shops. And we don't do that in Ireland. And we're finding now, as people are maybe avoiding dairy for various reasons, that we really have to think of iodine, because iodine is, I suppose, particularly important for brain development. So it's very important during pregnancy. So I think I'd be more worried about women of childbearing age. So when, if there are any, you know, of the teachers listening who are pregnant who don't take dairy, if they're taking an alternative, milk alternative, a beverage, a plant-based beverage, just look and choose the one that's got iodine added to it, or else think of a supplement or get some specific advice. For this age group, iodine is important. Their requirement is much lower, of course, than it is for, you know, for adults. But they'll get it, easily get it, if they're taking dairy. And if they're not taking dairy, the white fish, you know, maybe twice a week, and to have a, maybe to, we have a word separately. But there are very few children really on milk-free diets that are not attending a registered dietitian.
Okay, Mary, thanks for answering that one for me. So presumably then, Mary, you looked at, we'll say, those identified nutritional requirements alongside the up-to-date Irish dietary intake evidence. And what were your main findings of this group's dietary intakes?
Well, I think in terms of food, what hit us first of all might be we've a very high intake of processed meat. We seem to be very fond of ham, giving ham maybe to small children. And not only does that bring a lot of salt into this age group, but processed meats are recommended to be kept to a minimum, because there is a link, a higher link of colon cancer with processed meat. So sausages and ham, that's what we found initially. And we were, you know, it was then quite a challenge for us in modelling the diets to replace those foods, because they were giving the children iron, and iron is a very important nutrient, and iron is a problem nutrient in toddlers. So we had to be careful, and I'll talk about that maybe separately. The other things that we found is sugar intakes tended to be quite high, much higher at maybe 16% of energy in the one-year-olds, 20% in four-year-olds, compared with the WH ideal goal of less than 5% energy from sugar and less than 10% at least, if you could. Now, when we developed the diets, we found you could meet those targets. We weren't sure you could, but we tested them out by just, taking sugar out. So that was another challenge that actually didn't present us with much problems. Dietary fiber intake is usually adequate in the group. So the vitamins and minerals we worry about, vitamin D hits us straight off. The biggest source of vitamin D, the most important source for humans, is from sunshine. But of course, because of the risk of skin cancer, you protect children by putting on suntan lotion. But even putting on suntan lotion during the summer months, kids will get vitamin D from the sunshine. But when we come into winter, which is, we say Halloween to Patrick's Day, we are in a winter time for vitamin D. We're getting none. Even if we get a sunny day, the rays aren't strong enough to make vitamin D. So giving a supplement is absolutely essential. We modelled natural sources of vitamin D, which would be mainly oily fish, some margarines, fortified foods, and we still couldn't make it without that supplement during those months. That's one of the recommendations. So vitamin D was certainly not adequate. Iron is incredibly important for brain development, which I mentioned before. If you have a toddler that is iron deficient, they will feel tired. Physically, they won't be able to be active enough to make the most of their physical development. But cognitively, it also compromises their cognitive abilities. So that really holds them back. And in countries where we have gross malnutrition, due to inadequate food through famine or war, if there's persistent anemia, we know that that has a long-term permanent effect of stunting cognitive potential. So I don't think that's going to affect us in Ireland. If we have a child who runs into iron deficiency, it's corrected fairly quickly and reversed. But iron is a key nutrient. So what we found was that, red meat is obviously a very good source of absorbable iron. But we actually modelled vegetarian diets as well, thinking of sustainability and climate change. And we found on both diets that included meat and diets that didn't, that were plant-based but included eggs and milk, we could get enough iron if we took an iron-fortified cereal 5 days a week. So by a cereal, I mean a breakfast cereal. Yes. And the amount of iron needs to be about 12 milligrams per 100 grams. Now, the child will only take about 20 to 30 grams, but that's what to look for on the label is, and there's several cereals that would provide that amount. So okay. We'd say that's better than porridge, at least 5 days a week. That okay. We found really brought most of them over, it gave them an adequate intake. We found the smaller children from the 1 to 3 year age group, 1 to 3 year olds are the smallest, in terms of age and everything else. Mm-hmm. So the ones that are small naturally, through their genetics, they're yes. growing along the 25th percentile. We found there was a bit of a problem having an adequate iron intake in that group, purely because they needed less food. The smaller you are, the younger you are, obviously, you will have a lower food intake. So there's less chance then of you reaching the recommended amount of various vitamins and minerals. So we found that might be a problem for some very small children between the age of 1 to 3. And, so we've provided some advice to the government on that.
And Mary, so essentially what you're saying is you should seek medical advice, I suppose, before you would put your child on an iron supplement.
Absolutely. Iron supplements that are on the market, we in the Food Safety Authority actually regulate food supplements. They're regulated under food law. And we get notified all the food supplements that are put on the market. So we've been looking at these for many years, and it's always amazed me the very high dose that of iron that is present in supplements. And the higher the dose, the harder it is to actually tolerate it. So if you're on an iron supplement, you can have gastrointestinal effects. You can feel nauseated. Constipation is another side effect. So the dose of iron is important. It should be adequate, but not too high. So a medical supervision should be involved, and you shouldn't give it unless it's required. An iron supplement. But definitely the iron fortified foods. And what we found was through the modeling, we found, okay, which diets seem to make it? And they were the diets that had more fortified foods. And the obvious ones that came out in our modeling, looking at foods that are eaten in Ireland, were the breakfast cereals that were iron fortified. So that is an important message.
Yes. And just to say, Mary, in relation to that dietary intake evidence for Ireland, that is available. The surveys, the nutrition surveys, are available on the IUNA website, IUNA website. Yes. Mary, if we go back to the actual key recommendations of your report then, Mary, how would you, summarise your key recommendations then?
Right, I'm just looking now, and I hope I don't leave any out. Yeah. I suppose the ones that we were just talking about, if we maybe go through the food groups, would that be the better way?
Yes.
So, if we start at maybe the cereals, breads and potatoes, that a mixture of white and brown, and that when you're choosing breakfast cereals, choose a cereal fortified with iron, 12 milligrams per 100 grams of cereal. Okay. And a lot of them also include some vitamin D.
Right.
Mixture brown and white. When we come to the, maybe I'll go to the meat, poultry, fish and eggs. I'm not going through the pyramid.
Okay, no problem.
In order,
that's
if
right.
You don't mind.
It's fine. Yeah, no problem.
So meat, poultry, fish, eggs, beans, lentils and smooth nut butters are all good sources of protein. But they also, obviously, the red meat, the gives you iron. Poultry will give you some, and even fish will give you some, and iron and eggs. There's also a little bit of iron in beans and lentils, but from vegetable sources, it's less absorbed. So if you have a drink of orange juice next to foods like beans and lentils, you'll get more absorption of iron. Or, if, for example, that orange juice at breakfast. So we did recommend a little glass of orange juice at breakfast with that iron fortified cereal, and the children will absorb much more iron from it. So what we would say about red meat is it's a really good source of red meat, of bioavailable iron in the diet of 1 to 5 year olds. So about a small portion, 30 grams, 3 times a week, it will give an adequate amount. And then, the other days we would say fish, white fish up to twice a week, oily fish just once a week.
Okay.
And the oily fish gives DHA and EPA. Sorry,
Mary, I was just going to ask there, not at all, in relation to the portion size, are we suggesting the size of the child's hand palm for the meat?
That's the easiest way to do it.
Okay.
Same as with adults. So the smaller the child, the lower the amount required will be. And it works out about, for very small children, it can be as low as 25 grams, but it works about 30 grams up to 40 grams. And it depends. Like, some people like to have it just at one meal, but you are better with protein spread between two meals. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah.
So the unprocessed meats, keep them, keep it all unprocessed. Try and avoid the ham, sausages and deli meats, because of the link with cancer and the high salt content. They also are higher in fat. And then
Before you leave the meat group, Miriam, I just want to ask another question as well.
Yes.
In regard to tinned tuna, is that okay, Mary?
Tinned tuna is absolutely fine. It's a funny thing, tinned tuna, because tuna fish is oily, but the way it's processed for canning, you lose all the DHA and EPA, whatever way it's processed. You still get some vitamin D. Tuna is fine. Again, we have oily fish just once a week for this age group, and if it's white fish, up to twice. And that is because of, various contaminants that are in fish. Basically, for all of our diet, it's always good to have a mixture, and then you're not overdoing anything. So I hope I've answered that.
Yes, no, you were going to move on to the milk group there and I cut across you. So Mary,
you're all right. Eggs, beans and lentils, they will give you non-heme iron. So we in our modelling did have vegetarian days, you know, with baked beans on toast is a very good protein source for children. And again, the vitamin C containing foods or vegetables, maybe with or diluted fruit juice, will increase iron absorption. And then I can go on to the dairy group.
Yes, please.
And I'm just looking at my notes here, but I could nearly do it better from my knowledge, which is 500 to 600 mils of milk is what we recommend, but we do not recommend that all as a milk drink, because that's quite dilute and it kind of overwhelms a child's appetite. So like that can be split into a 200 ml drink of milk, and you probably wouldn't give that all in one go. You'd probably split that between two little drinks for the younger children. So 200 mils is, you know, the beaker you see at the water cooler fountains?
Yes.
Those little beakers, they're exactly 200 mils. So that's one portion. So 600 mils of milk is three of those. But each one of those cups, if you give a yogurt, 125 gram yogurt, an ordinary yogurt, or two petit filous, that's equivalent to one of those cups of milk. Or if you give, looking at your two thumbs as an adult now, if everybody's looking at their two thumbs, that's about an ounce of cheese, and that will also give you everything that you need from one of those 200 ml cups of milk. So in other words, a mixture of cheese, yogurt and milk to drink is the best way of approaching the dairy group.
And are we saying low fat there, Mary, if possible?
We're saying full fat up to the age of two, and then low fat from the age of two. And we modelled many different types of milk, because to be honest, if you were looking at a pyramid, you'd nearly put milk on the bottom shelf for this age group, because it is the most important food in their diet. And it not only provides calcium, it's a really important source of protein, but it's given as milk, yogurt and cheese. We actually modelled the recommendation the Irish government have, which is breastfeed if you can up to the age of two. And we actually published a paper in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition on this, because it was one of the first pieces of scientific evidence to show a real benefit of breastfeeding to age two in terms of nutrition, because it was the only milk feeding methods that met the needs for DHA and EPA. And these are omega-3 fatty acids, and DHA is in breast milk. Like the mother produces DHA, and that's provided in the breast milk. Now, of course, many people don't breastfeed at the age of two. So from the age of one, cow's milk can be given as a drink. It should be full fat till they're two, but we modelled from the age of two, the lower fat is what we'd recommend, because it has everything else in it. It just is cutting back on the saturated fat.
And Mary, what about the plant-based milk replacements? You know, those milk beverages, the soya milk, etc.
You really, if you're not taking the dairy group, I would strongly recommend that you are receive dietary advice individually from a registered dietitian, because it's a very important group. And those plant-based beverages, some of them are totally devoid of protein. And if they're not fortified, your child won't get enough calcium. The dairy food is critical for those nutrients.
Yes.
So there are children who can't take cow's milk because of allergy, and there's good alternatives. But make sure you seek from a qualified health care professional. And my advice out there is go look for a Karoo registered dietitian. So go to karoo.ie and you can check the registration there to make sure that the person is adequately qualified. Because if children don't get adequate calcium, their bones are growing and developing. So it's just very important
to
say that. Yes.
And Mary, the other thing I wanted to ask you about there in relation to the milks are, you know, the children's milks that are marketed by food companies for, yes. you know, 2 to 3 year old toddlers. Are they necessary?
Yes. No, they're not necessary. They are fortified milks. And surprisingly, even though they do add EPA and DHA, they weren't as good as breast milk. So that was our big finding, if you like.
Yes,
the other downside of them is that they're very high in sugar. But I believe that the manufacturers are going to be doing something about that, because there's a standard that's been developed by the WHO and FAO at Codex, which is going to make it mandatory that the sugar content of these toddler milks, which you see on the market for 1 to 2 year olds and 2 to 3 year olds, that the sugar content has to be curtailed. Because we found it, if we modelled children on those milks, they were getting 12% energy from sugar. They were getting way over the recommended amount, whereas most of the other diets we modelled, all of them, had met the WHO target of 5 to 6% energy from sugar. The other thing is they can be expensive. But on the good side, if you have a small child who, you know, I remember I said they won't be able to eat enough, maybe to get enough iron, mm-hmm. Even taking the iron fortified cereal, if they're between the age of 1 and 3, simply because their capacity for food is so limited because they're tiny. So between the age of 1 to 3, we, you know, these milks can provide that extra 4 milligrams of iron. So that is the one group that, you know, may benefit. The other option would be to take a supplement at a very low dose. We're talking all about right. 7 milligrams.
Okay. And Mary, then I suppose the fruit and vegetables.
Yes. I was going to say, I hope we won't leave those out. yes. Fruit, salad and vegetables are obviously very important sources of vitamins and fiber. And I'm not so worried about the fiber side of it. The vitamins are important. I think the biggest issue here for the 1 to 5 year olds is getting them used to the variety of very strong flavors that are in this food group. So what we recommend is that a portion of vegetables should always be included at the main meal. And then in addition, a number of small pieces of fruit, salad or vegetables included to match the age of the child. For example, if the child is 1, it has its portion of vegetables at the main meal, and then it has one other small piece of fruits, mixture of fruits, salad or vegetables. If the child is 2, move it up to two pieces or two portions. And if it's 3, we go to 3, and if it's 4, we go to 4, and eventually we get to 5. And the amount of, when I say small, everybody's thinking, what does she mean? Look at the child, ask the child to hold it in its hand. That's the size.
That's the size.
So it's easy. And really, the best thing to do is make it interesting. You can chop the edge off a banana, for example, and all you have to do when you go back later in the day is chop the end off that's gone a bit brown, you know. Yeah. And you give a little bit of banana, a few, you know, little blueberries, you know, make
variety.
The most of the colour.
Yeah.
Make the most of variety. And when you put a salad on the table, which you should do, you know, put mandarin oranges in, put sweet corn in, put some things that will mean the child is successful.
Yes.
That, you know, a child doesn't like anything, but actually likes mandarin oranges. Okay, we stick some of those in. And then you build on that as they grow. And I promise you can come after me when they're 20 if they haven't. But I can swear now they'll be, they will, you know, get through that challenge of the very strong flavours and the textures. So they'll put it in their mouth, they'll spit it out, they'll put it through their hair, let them do all that. It's all exploring. And until they say they've refused it 20 times, you don't say they don't like it. That's the worst thing you can say. Just take it away for the moment and introduce it again 6 months later. Before we leave the fruit and vegetables, I have to ask you, what was the rationale for not moving the fruit and veg to the bottom shelf of the pyramid, like the adult version?
Well, simply because the idea of the pyramid was initially was to give you a glance of where most of your foods should come from. So the bottom shelf is the biggest. So to be honest, if we were being really honest with the food pyramid, for the 1 to 3 rows, we'd probably have milk on the bottom. But we certainly, the fruit, salad and vegetables wouldn't be as important as the, calories from the carbohydrates, the pastas, the rice. So we didn't swap them. Like, it would be giving the wrong message, because fruit, salads and vegetables are bulky, low in energy. And while they give good vitamins and minerals, you really do need your dairy. Your dairy is very important because of the nutrients it gives. You need your meats, you need your beans, peas, lentils, your nut butters, all those for protein, all those foods. So that was the idea, that, right, you know, for the older children who are, you know, have the capacity to eat much more, it's true, the fruit, salads and vegetables, by the time they're 5, they're on 5 portions a day. So then it's true that it should go on the bottom.
Yep. And you better say a word about the fats, spreads and oils, Mary.
Yes. Well, fat spreads and oils, like for all age groups, should be used minimally. 1 gram of fat gives you 9 calories. 1 gram of sugar will give you less than 4. 1 gram of protein gives you less than 4. So fat spreads and oils are just very energy dense. A small amount of fat spread can be added to bread to make it more palatable. But frying of food should be avoided as far as possible. Steam, bake, grill. Maybe roast potatoes or thick cut oven chips, as I said, once a week. If you're using fat or oil, people always ask, it would really be the same advice as for older age groups, that the unsaturated spreads are a good idea. But obviously a little bit of butter is lovely for the taste.
Yes, I know.
But it should be kept, you know, to a small amount. So I hope I've...
I suppose, Mary, I have a few meal planning guidelines that I'd actually, ask you to, I suppose, explain in relation to the food pyramid, you know, for this age group. So I suppose essentially what you're saying is to try as many of the food groups as possible, would it be at the 2 main meals?
Yes.
To include them.
Yes. Yeah. And I had actually in the, you know, on the Safe Food website,
okay,
the resources for healthy eating. And I'm just going to see if I can bring them up here.
No problem. I know that you would say too, Mary, on that website, that we would be saying like that, you know, that size matters. So you have smaller plates, smaller mugs, and then, you'll end up with smaller portions, etc. Yeah,
absolutely. And the healthy eating for 1 to 4 year olds, although we went for 1 to 5 year olds in our scientific advice, we only go up to the 5th birthday. So you could say they're during their 4th year. So the Department of Health wanted to put it out as 1 to 4 year olds, because they talk about the food pyramid then for the older, for everybody else, has been 5+.
Okay.
So that is available on the Safe Food website. And I'd strongly recommend all the home economics teachers bring this to the attention of the Leaving Cert students.
Yes.
Because not only does it give the meal plans, but it goes through all that I've said in food-based terms. It shows portion sizes. You know, the recommended side plate for a child. Don't have a big adult plate and hardly anything on it. That's, the cups, the fact that 100 mils of milk, which is half of that little cup that I was talking about, that you find at the water cooler counter.
Yeah.
And then it also gives you, how many servings, like 3 servings a day of the milk, cheese and yogurt. That's what we split it into, and how the fruit and vegetables work out, like 2 to 3 servings a day for 1 and 2. And then when they're up to 4 and 5, you know, they increase. And then there are meal patterns. So we go through all the food groups and the servings of meat and chicken, you know, the very tiny amounts for the smaller children. You know, an egg can be half an egg. And then these resources go into the meal patterns at the end. For example, for a one-year-old child, breakfast can be a cup. Now, here it says 200. I think 100 is enough, but sometimes the cup of milk can be split to go over the cereal as well as to drink. Half a mandarin orange and 2 tablespoons of iron-fortified wheat flakes, for example. At lunch, it could be 15 grams of cheddar cheese. So that's one thumb, if you like. Two tablespoons of tomato pasta sauce and 3 tablespoons of cooked macaroni. And then at dinner time, it's the set of vegetables that we talked about and 30 grams of chopped chicken. So that'd be about the palm of the hand without the fingers and thumb of a one-year-old. And half a scoop of mashed potato and a fromage fray. And the snacks, because the child has a tiny capacity, some of those meals might be split into little snacks. They might manage it all at one meal. Yeah. But a mid-morning snack that would be good for the bigger children of one is a fromage fray, maybe on top of those 3 meals that I described. The mid-afternoon snack could be one cracker with peanut butter, smooth peanut butter. And an evening snack could be a small portion of milk or breast milk.
And Mary, then, can I just ask you there, in relation to the snacks, are we still saying that popcorn and peanuts should be avoided for reasons of choking?
Oh, definitely, because there's nothing worse than when a child chokes. And I think all of us who have had children or look after children have been through that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no. I suppose one rule would be don't allow children to run around while they're eating. Because no matter what they're eating, that's a recipe for them going, and that aspiration or taking in a breath can mean they, you know, aspirate a piece of food, and that's a choking hazard. But the problem with the popcorn or the peanuts or any nuts is that it doesn't dissolve. So when they aspirate it, it's a real choking hazard. So we would say just make sure they sit. I don't like seeing them running around eating. But I have seen children, like toddlers, out running around eating nuts, and they shouldn't. Like, I'd be careful about nuts. I'd give it as a smooth, butter paste. You know, a smooth paste. Then in those resources that are on the Safe Food website. You'll also see a sample meal plan for a three-year-old, and you'll see how different that
different
is.
Yes.
And, you know, an egg, unsweetened orange juice for breakfast, slice of wholemeal toast, you know, as an alternative to the cereals. And a mid-morning snack can be some raspberries or berries or banana and a fromage fray. The afternoon could be cheese and rice cake, for example. Or going to bed as well as the drink, they might have a little half slice of banana bread, and their dinner time will just be bigger. And their lunch time, like, I think in here we have a vegetarian option because we've got some vegetarian advice in this: a falafel and hummus, and some cherry tomatoes and a small pita bread, half a pita bread, you know, and then dinner. There's salmon and carrots and mashed potato and a little bit of rice pudding. So all of those, how you take the information from all the food groups that we talked about, you know, the bread, cereals and potatoes, and how you populate that into the three meals and the three snacks. The problem in the baby food sector, it's worth saying this, is that they seem to have, some of the manufacturers seem to have interpreted that children need snacks like adults, and that's the last thing they need. So we have done a survey of baby foods. We've just completed one recently, and we completed another one in 2017 and before that in 2012. And we found, to our horror, that there were foods like biscuits, chocolate, crisp-like products. They were low in salt, but they were essentially the same as crisps for babies and for young children, and they are totally inappropriate. Those foods will not provide the nutrients that a child of this age needs, but they will give calories. So if a child is to meet its nutrition requirements, it's going to go overboard in calories because it'll have to eat other food to get the nutrients.
I know.
You know, yes. Or else they won't get the adequate nutrition. So what we mean by snacks is breaking up, if you like, the meals into mini meals is maybe the way we, I think, it's described. Okay. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for that, Mary. It was really informative. And thank you for joining me today. And also thank you to our listeners for tuning in. And you have been listening to the Home Economics podcast series brought to you by the Centre of Excellence for Home Economics at St. Angela's College. We'll see you next time. Thank you.